know, just having the opportunity to live a creative existence. I just feel really lucky being a person who's born, you know, with this as being what was in store for me, is to pretty much just make my life a constant creativity. And when it's not creative, it's doing the things that a person does to make themselves the best they can be to be creative, you know. I do remember at that time when I started playing when I was seven, somebody taught me the beginning of Stairway to Heaven, but they couldn't teach me the solo, and that was what I wanted to learn. Eventually, my family agreed to buy me a Strat based on that I'd learned the whole Sex Pistols album on acoustic guitar, and to show them that I was dedicated. And then I got a Strat, and then, you know, so no, I never named it, but a Strat from like 1982 was my first guitar that I really put my love into.
When I was 9 or 10 years old, when I got into punk rock, you know, that was the whole world that I felt within me that wasn't going on around me at school, that made me feel like I had no reason to exist, that in rock and roll, that was part of everyday living, and that gave me a reason to live.
I used to be like, in seventh grade, I would walk into music stores and just everybody would think I was an amazing guy because I was about this tall and I could play all these Hendrix songs.
Oh, really?
You know? Yeah. When you hear Jimi Hendrix play, it's a pure expression of him as a person. You see him on stage and there's absolutely no separation between him and his guitar. They're completely one because he's just putting every single bit of everything in his whole psyche and every single part of his body into his guitar playing.
I just idolized Flea and Anthony. I thought they were the be-all, end-all, greatest people in the world before I was in the band. They were just my favorite. They were my favorite stars.
I felt like Hallel was just starting to try to figure something out and was stopped. But in retrospect, now I just, you know, feel like his spirit really lives on within us, within our band, as well as I feel at peace with, you know, it was time for him to go.
John Frusciante was a huge Hallel Slovak fan and a student of Hallel, more or less.
I met Flea through my friend DH, and Flea was considering having me in the Chili Peppers when Hallel died. When I first joined the band when I was 18, Flea and Anthony called me up. I kept real cool when I was on the phone with them, and then I hung up the phone and I screamed, "How in the world are Chili Peppers?" And I ran across the house.
When I joined the band, I couldn't believe that they like wanted to be this other thing than they were, you know? Like, they didn't think, like, I thought of them as huge stars, you know? But to them, they weren't famous yet, you know, and they hadn't made it yet. But it didn't bother me, I was happy as hell. But I hoped that we would stay at the level that we were at in popularity.
We'd felt that EMI really didn't have a clue what to do with the Chili Peppers.
Thank you.
What Rick Rubin does as a producer is that he lets you be you. He's able to pick a place for you that you'll be comfortable with, that you wouldn't see for yourself.
About, you know, is about being free and not being tied down to anything, not trying to fit into any mold or any style or any category.
In the world,
we felt that aluminum foil and obnoxious secretaries would just put a monkey wrench into our music, and we didn't want one.
I wouldn't let anything at all that I thought wasn't directly aimed at helping my creativity come out, I treated as if it was a knife to my heart.
I've never taken anything so seriously in my life, and I've never been so proud of anything that I've ever done, because I've always felt like I was a failure.
I drive on the streets 'cause she's my companion. I walk through the hills 'cause she knows who I am. She sees my good deeds and she kisses the wind. Well, I never worried, now that is a
never entered my head. It was never a thought that went through my head that said, people are going to buy this and listen to it. A lot of people all over the world.
Going to go back to life as actual human beings instead of monks.
I just didn't like the way everybody was responding to the success that we were having. I was confused myself about how to deal with it.
Going out on tour, like, reality just hit me, you know? Like, I just hated the whole rock star thing, and I hated, I wouldn't sign autographs. I would walk out of the dressing room, and if there'd be, like, a crowd of, like 100 people, like, waiting for me to walk out of the backstage into the bus, I'd just have a juice bottle with me all the time. And I'd break the bottle of juice, and the people would all like spread out, you know, because there was all this glass flying all over the place, and I'd just run into the bus.
Flea took this drive to the park after that tour, and we were sitting there, and he said, is there anything you like about being in the band? And I said, no, there's nothing I like about being in the band at all. And he goes, nothing. And then I said, nothing except for playing with you. I love you. That's why I'm in the band, because I love playing with you. And he was like, oh, well, God, that's no reason to stay in the band if you're not happy, you know.
Hey, John Frusciante. Due to mental stresses and imbalances and difficulty of dealing with everything, quit the band and left.
I don't think that death is a big deal. I don't care if I die right now. Doesn't mean I'm self-destructive. I really love life, and I think that's the only way to love life. What I've come to find is what's smart is being able to trip out, you know? That's using more parts of your brain. That's your subconscious at work. That's lining up thoughts that are that and doing really intense things to your whole existence here and in all your other lives that are going on simultaneously. I feel great. If I didn't feel great, I'd change the way I live. I'd start running or something. I feel great. Have lots of energy. I'm writing all the time, writing music all the time. I write a lot in notebooks. Like, I go through like a notebook every couple of weeks and just do writing of all kinds, movie scripts, idea, just stuff off the top of my head, like mathematics, all sorts of things. I released my record is because there's not that much good music around nowadays, and that was how my friends convinced me. It's like there's no good music around really now. Like, to me, the really good music, like Jane's Addiction and Jimi Hendrix and just things of that caliber, has the same vibe as Da Vinci in my head. Like, there's something in it that ties together all artists from all times. And no bands around now really have it.
Some of it was recorded while I was in the Chili Peppers, because I didn't, I don't consider myself I was doing it, but where my real spirits come from, I am not like a funk guitarist. It's not what I am. I have music that would be like as heavy as Jane's Addiction or something in as terms of feelings that it gives you, but at the same time, like, had acoustic guitars and was more soothing, like Elton John or Tyrannosaurus Rex or something, like, or things that were more catchy, and also with the what they call weirdness, but to me it's just more free expression of like Captain Beefheart the Magic Man.
I think it's interesting in that you can hear the decline that I was going on inside. I think that those last two songs on it are the best songs on the record, but at the same time, it's very sad because I hear when I hear it that it sounds like a person falling apart, or it sounds like somebody about to kill themselves or something.
Oh. and he ended up in rehab. He reached out to me and said, "Hey man, you know, I'm stuck in here. Can you bring me a guitar? Because I, you know, I can't play. I have nothing to play." He's like, "No problem." So I got a, I had a Sunburst Les Paul guitar, this Les Paul, and I had it, and I was like, "Yeah man, you know, I'll loan you this Les Paul and I'll bring it down." So I brought the Les Paul down to where he was in the facility. We hung out, we talked a little bit, and I never saw it again. 10 years later, he comes up, knocks on the door, and he's got a guitar case, and he opens it up, and it's a black Les Paul, and he goes, "I just wanted to give this to you because years ago, you gave me a Les Paul, and I sold it and bought drugs with it."
You saw sarcasm, Mr. Know-it-all. Close your eyes and I'll kiss you, cuz with the birds of shame.
Joined the band because I love playing music all the time, having that to think about it all the time, and I could tell that they, you know, that they were going to be like receptive and sensitive to what I would try to do, you know, by devoting my life to music, you know. A note that occurs after 20 seconds of silence is not the same note that would have occurred before the 20 seconds if you just heard the note at 0 seconds. Mm. You know, the note that occurs to 20 seconds or the note that occurs in 40 seconds, those are new notes. You know, those are notes that are created out of the silence.
Silence
is part of the note. First got successful, the way they were responding to it is not at all the way they respond to their success now. I mean, as I said before, Anthony's made a kind of progress spiritually and inwardly. The way he was responding to the success at the beginning, I just see it as having its place, whereas at the time it made me angry at it. And now, if he had to respond to it that way to get himself to the point where he's at now, it all makes sense.
Kind of like the idea of when you subtract all that space that can go in between two things, like if you were to just play it like this, as opposed, it just creates this dimension to it, because then you've got a high thing and a low thing, and it's basically like two things rather than just playing a chord, which makes it just like one thing.
Well, around the time of Californication, The Cure were one of my favorite bands, and I think, especially like the song itself, Californication, what I was laying there listening to The Cure. Anthony had had this vocal idea that had been swimming around that I couldn't figure out what to put behind it for the chords. And so I was listening to this song. It's this half an hour long, it's a 25 minute long instrumental. If you hear it, it sounds just like Californication. Dun, 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 dun.
Imagining that my body was a tape recorder, I knew 3 years ago that I was going to have to record Only Water for 10 days in order to be able to make a record. I really had to clean myself out before I was going to be able to do a clear representation of the feelings and the places that I wanted to represent with my music. My music, it's me. It's, you know, it's me just trying to mirror the feelings that because I hear the textures in my head as feelings, and then I try to find the electronic sounds to match the feelings in my head.
I probably listen to 70% electronic music or 80% electronic music. Most of what I listen to is all different types of electronic music, you know, from all different kinds of techno musics and German electronic music from the 70s. And when we were making Californication, I actually had to make a rule for myself that I would only listen to electronic music at nighttime, and during the daytime I would only listen to music played by real instruments, because if I listened to electronic music and then I went to rehearsal, everything sounded so boring to me, you know?
A lot of the time I'd be improvising and singing. I was sort of trying to find myself as a songwriter when I was making the music that I released as those two albums. The songs were more experiments than they were actual compositions. And now, ever since I started playing guitar again 3 years ago and writing songs again, it's been my idea to, when the inspiration for a song comes to me, it's my responsibility to finish that song. And to...